next, we have Malaysia Market Outlook by Fernanda, Head of Research, Mr. Chan Ken Yu. He is the Chief Strategist of Fernanda Research, analyzing the overall equity market direction and market economy condition. Prior to his current work, Mr. Chan was a Head of Research of MIMB with an investment bank. He was also a Vice President in OSK Venture International Berhad, OSK BI. In 2009, he acted as Director for Evox Berhad and MNC Wireless Berhad on behalf of OSK BI. In more than 10 years' experience in the equity market, he had received a handful of awards. Just to name a few, he was rated as the second best property analyst by the Age Malaysia in year 2004. In 2009, Financial Times and Starline ranked him as the top three banking analysts in Pan Asia. During the same year, he was also awarded as the top 10 overall stock picker in Asia as well. Moreover, Mr. Chan held a Master of Finance from RMIT University from Australia. Lastly, he also obtained a Bachelor of Property Management from University of Malaya. Without further ado, let us invite Mr. Chan Ken Yu, Head of Research of Fernanda International Bank, to bring us about the Malaysia Market Outlook 2016.
Hi, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, I would like to express my greatest gratitude for your attendance today. It is a weekend. I know it's quite tough to get up at an early morning like this. It's a beautiful morning, right? Okay. Before I go through my market outlook, probably I just to give you some idea about the Malaysian economy as a whole. This year we're looking at 5.1% GDP growth, slightly on the high side. Probably I think we need to make a decision after the budget revision announcement in the middle of this month. In terms of sectors that will actually pull the entire GDP growth, most likely for us I think is still the private investment side. Private consumption probably I think will start to stabilize after 1 year after the GST implementation. Also, I think we're looking at in terms of sectors, we are quite hopeful that the construction will do well, although I think we might see potential minor reductions or prioritizing certain projects after the revised budget announcement. But I think to us, I think the strategy is very clear. We still like those public interest kind of mega project like MRT, I think that kind of project shouldn't have any problem and it should actually continue by the government. In terms of interest rate, most likely we think we still remain unchanged. If you look at the Bank Negara monthly policy statement, they always emphasize growth before they talk about inflation. And if you look at inflation numbers right now, I think it's not really big or concern to the government. So it's still manageable. So therefore, I think the focus we've seen the growth side. In order to stimulate the growth, I think the interest rate, if not going down, I think they're most likely to be able to maintain at this level. Other things, I think that is roughly the entire, I would say, backdrop of the economy. Now, in terms of market, to us, I think our mind is very clear. We have been talking about the volatility if US start to increase interest rate, because we don't think the first round interest rate hike in the US have actually priced in the market. because it's always his market perception is that once you have the starting of the first hike, they may actually expect a series of hikes in later quarter or later months. If you're based on the consensus basically looking at 75 basis point hike in interest rate in US in this year, next year they're looking at 100 basis point. It's a part of an aggressive, I would say, the high interest rate. But with all those expectations, definitely I think uncertainty will continue to cause a lot of volatility in the capital market and also the capital flows. And therefore, I think for market, I think the most likely will be stuck in a range bound. Why we say so? I think if you look at on the upside, firstly, I think the remaining catalyst is not there. If you look at the recent result announcement, I think although I think most of us actually have factored in about tough operating environment, post GST, all those things, we are factored in the slower top line and maybe start speaking margin. But if you look at the result, recent results, still I think more than one third of the company under our coverage still deliver bigger than expected result. That means to say we have yet to really see a strong catalyst in the corporate earnings. And secondly, if you look at the foreign flow, there have been net seller to our broker equity market. Entire year of 2015, foreigners sold about 13 billion ringgit in our market, and 2014 also I think close to 10 billion. So we have been net seller since the third quarter of 2013. And I think when can actually this trend to be reversed or tapering off? If you look at the foreign shareholding for CI, this is based on our estimate. This level, this absolute level, is with the strategic shareholders. And if you take out the foreign strategic shareholder, it's still considered relatively high, close to 18%. If they want to continue to sell down, I think how low can they go? Probably, I think they will actually reverse back to the level that actually we saw in 2012. That is about 4 percentage point for the foreigner to continue to sell down. That will probably translate into 30 to 35 billion potential outflow if they want to continue to sell down. But of course, I think nobody knows where is the floor. So far, I think based on our analysis, that I think the estimated foreign shareholding is pretty near to the two standard deviation below the 1 year moving average. So normally when you near this kind of level, it tends to be kind of near bottom kind of scenario. So hopefully we will see the foreign selling to tapering off. But in order to assess the foreign flow better, we actually introduced this new model in the previous in the last quarter. We borrowed the idea of a multiple asset allocation from foreign portfolio theory. We actually can make an assumption. Imagine yourself is a global investor, global portfolio manager. You can actually invest or short sell in, let's say, here I'm using a 12 countries indices as a sample. Say you can actually buy or sell in the global market. You want to have a target return in your portfolio of 10%. Because you are a foreign investor right now, you need your return in US dollar. And you want to optimize your portfolio risk to such a down to the minimum, the lowest possible. And the outcome actually is shown in this table. If you look at the proposed weight for CI during the months of May to July, it's actually hovering around close to 8%. So it's a fairly, I would say, equal weights, because one over 12 country, let's say you put equal weight to all the countries, market for 3%. So we are quite there, we are on the average. But in August last year, the things actually turned quite drastically. The proposed rate for CI, back then, I think based on the data, actually, it advised the investor to short sell up to 22%. And that percentage actually has been, I would say, increased. And I think based on the December data, it's still a negative 33% kind of most with. That means to say, based on this model, they actually, as a foreigner, they actually advise you to actually consider such stuff in order to get a return of about 10% in US dollar term. The reason is because, I think, mainly because of the ringgit. Because ringgit in July to August, just 1 month itself, month on month, it actually declined by about 9.4, or depreciated by about 9.4%. That is a big percentage, 9.4. Remember, I think in this example, we use a target rate of 10%. So instead of invest, you will source up, you will actually get your close to 9% return rate. You don't need the market to move and to go anywhere. Straight from a currency, you can actually make such a gain. So in order for the foreigner to stop selling, probably I think maybe is one of the major factors. That means to say we have to see the ringgit start to strengthening, or at least to stabilize and to make our market to start to move up. Then only we will see the foreign selling actually start to have ring. Otherwise, I think that the pressure is still there for the local market in terms of foreign selling. Now, another observation we can make from here is that one of the criteria I use to optimize the portfolio is that I want to optimize in such a way to the lowest possible risk. And if let's say Malaysian market, let's say is still perceived as a low beta market, that means to say you shouldn't see such a strong selling. But the fact that if you have such a selling, that means to say foreigner may not actually view us as a low beta market. If you are not a low beta market, what does it mean? It means that you cannot actually command premium valuations over your regional peers. If you look at the CI, you've got PER, 4 PER for CI, you always trade at a premium to the regional market. And the common, I would say the reasoning they use is because we are a low beta in nature. And that actually premium, if you look at this line here, have been in a downtrending mode for some time. And I think the only chance that when the market or the valuation of CI can expand as is when your premium actually less than 5% against your regional peers. And if let's say your regional peer, let's say for instance they are trading at a lower PE than you, it means that it is harder for us to justify for CI valuation, and therefore your upside is actually limited in a sense. Now, how about on the domestic front? We talked about the foreign flow, the domestic liquidity, how is it? I think domestic liquidity has been our strongest argument for the market to remain to be supportive. And it has been supporting the market in a sense. But only recently it raised some concern. It's because our excess liquidity in the banking system have declined in a very, drastic manner. If you look at the excess liquidity in the banking system, during earlier of the year, it was comfortably stood above 300 billion ringgit. But at the end of the year, it's actually slightly above the 200 billion ringgit. If you look at this green line here, the excess liquidity, it dropped or declined very fast, just within, I think, less than half a year. So such a strong reduction in the liquidity is not good for the CI, because if you look at the correlation, CI tend to move higher if the liquidity improves. And in fact, after the liquidity actually formed a peak during mid-2012, the CI actually slowly, I think, showed sign of weakness. Therefore, I think for the CI to continue to move higher, I believe your excess liquidity have to actually form a strong comeback or rebound from here. Otherwise, it is hard to support the CI movement. And I think the government recognized that. This is probably why they reintroduced value cap into the market to provide liquidity in our market. If you recall, I think a recent announcement, they announced 20 billion reintroduction of value cap. And that actually with the hope that to revise the market sentiment. Now, what kind of impact or what kind of benefit we can actually get from this 20 billion. We tried to do a study on the impact of this 20 billion. We checked back our previous case. I think value cap is not something new. It was introduced during the end 2012 and it was, operated during 2013. 2013, the initial capital back then was about 5 billion. That accounts for about 2% of the CI market cap back then. And 20 billion right now also accounted for about 2% of the CI market cap right now. So meaning to say the amount in terms of percentage of market cap is fairly similar, about 2%. And what can we expect from this 2%? Can we expect such a strong performance during 2003, where CI saw a V-shaped recovery after the commencement of a value cap? Can we? 30-odd%, 35%, anyone? Although we want to be hopeful, but I think in the reality probably I think we have to discount that. Because back then, 2003, Dow Jones also up by about 31.5%. And for CI, that time we were up by about 35.5%. So it's only 4 percentage point outperformance during the introductions of America. And if let's say we attribute such a outperformance solely to value cap, that means to say the 2% fresh capital to put in the market potentially may generate up to 4% additional return. That 4% out of the 4.2 is definitely from a fresh capital, and 2% probably is from the revival of the investors' sentiment. And we saw that during the announcement of the what I call it, this value cap. We saw the sentiment actually make a reversal just after the announcement. But also, I think this slide actually prepared during the end of last year. That time we said, although it had reversed the sentiment, but it looks like it showed some published sign. Now, I just want to just to explain these two charts, how we use them to measure the investor sentiment. Now, this first chart is actually using the PR multiple discount between the FBN small cap and also the CI. In a nutshell, when the market is bullish, investor will tend to go for mid and small cap, and therefore your mid or small cap valuation will play a catch up against your mid cap, and therefore your discount should narrow. And when your discount narrow, that means to say it says that the market is bullish or is kind of optimist in the sense. When the discount actually widens, that means to say market is more risk averse. Investor actually shift from a small and big cap to big cap, and therefore small mid cap valuation will decline, and your big cap will actually increase, and therefore the discount will decline. And we actually saw that reversal just after the announcement of value cap, and that actually showed that the investor sentiment back then was improving. But I think even so, I think if you look at the PR bank discounts over the this multiple discount bank, it tend to actually show that the market sentiment tend to be toppish if they actually trading close to one standard deviation above the mean. And only in the bull market you can see the sentiment shot up to the two standard deviation. So back then we said the probably is a early sign of a toppishness during end of last year. So we think that probably short-term pullback is likely. And the same thing goes to the discount between the CI and the consensus. Same thing. Normally, CI will trade a discount to the consensus simply because, let's say, you have, say, 10% upside kind of expectation, but CI normally would go up to 10%. It will actually tend to go up maybe close to 6 or 7%, then you actually bring some room because by then, then most of the investors will start to take profit because for that additional 3% they can actually get from the fixed income of the bond market, so they don't actually move up to the 10% expectation unless you can actually just see higher return. So you actually keep on increase your expectation, then only the market can go higher. Let's say without that, normally they will trade at a certain discount. And that discount also can be measured, and also is a sign or it can be a timing tools for us. And normally the market tend to dropish when they actually hit one standard deviation above the mean, and it's very clear cut. And during the end of last year, we are approaching that level. That also is why we say the short term pullback is fairly likely. But again, what kind of upside can we expect? That is another question we want to ask ourselves. Okay, in the slightly longer term, we said that probably I think the upside can be actually limited in the sense because the valuations. Valuations for CI is not cheap. If you look at our earning growth estimate for this year, we are only looking at 3.9%. We are very conservative compared with consensus. Consensus is looking at about 6.7%. We are looking at 3.9%. For next year, we are looking at 3.1%. Solely because of the low base we have in FY16 consensus, despite the higher base, also they are looking at 9.6%. So we are very conservative in that sense. And with such a conservative expectation, therefore, our CI target is, I would say, is very conservative. We are looking at about 1775 as our index target. But at 1775, that actually implies about close to 20 times FY16 PE, close to 18 times FY17 PE. And that PE probably, I think, is at the higher end of the historical range. If you look at the historical, normally CI PE tend to actually peak at about 17 and a half. And that also will only happen during the bull market. In the normal market condition, normally they tend to fluctuate between the plus one and negative one standard deviation down level. So you can clearly see sometimes, most likely, let's say under normal market condition, they actually will trade at the one standard deviation level. This is also the another reason why we said that probably the upside probably is getting limited, and therefore that actually make us believe that the market most likely is checked in a range bound kind of mode. And how we trade this range, if our view is right, then we should actually buy into weakness if and when the CI actually dip below 1620, which is right now, I think. We have been talking about this level for us, I think the IP buying level for us, I think for the past 2 days, it is a good level for us to start nimble. And now we hope that we can actually sell above the 1.7 and 1.0. That is our selling zone. And in fact, that selling zone actually come earlier after we issued a strategy during the end of last year. During early January, it went up to, I think, it was 1.7. That was the high back then, and it was our selling zone. So we were able to catch the fish side. Hopefully this round we can catch the bottom. That is in terms of timing of the investment. In terms of sector allocations, so far we are quite optimistic over construction. As I say, I think that is one of the sectors we have to look at. Although we are very selective, we only look at those public interest, so called the mega project like MRT. So in for this sector, we have Kim Moon as our topic. We have been calling Kim Moon as our topic for the last two quarters. I think the previous quarter was not so well received, but only recent quarters, I think suddenly investors realized that, and I think that the price is actually playing a catch up right now, and I think it's almost hit our target price. We are considering reviewing our target price at the moment. Export-oriented, like the glove sector, is still our favorite. And also, I think power utility, which is upgraded after the, mainly because we upgraded to another because of the 1MVP issue is over. So I think it's time to look at another. In times of uncertainty, we think we want to stay defensive or to stay fairly resilient kind of sectors. I think power utility is definitely one of them. We have the two newly added neutral sectors like plastic packaging and technology and semicon. It used to be our favorite sectors. I think in the previous quarter, we have been calling outperform or overweight in these two sectors simply because they are export oriented. But I think your recent run up in the share price, I think the variation is no longer attractive. Therefore, I think we just downgraded some of the stock to market performance. Therefore, we have downgraded the sector as a whole as well. And semicon, we I think together with Blur, we also have to be very selective. We actually adopt a different kind of approach. We are we only look at certain, certain ingredients in our stock picks. Like for instance, if we are looking at those who still trading at the relatively lower PE compared with their peers. Therefore, we have top glove traders, I think, still trade at about 20 times PE. During its glory days, top glove used to trade at 25. So we have yet to reach its peak PE. Also, I think if you compare with the peers like Fosun and Arthur, like, both of these two glove sector, actually, both of these two glove stocks actually trade about, if I'm not missing, it's about 23, 24 times. Hatta, I think, is close to 27 times forward PE. So in terms of valuation, they are slightly cheaper. So therefore, we still have top glove in our mind. For technology and semicon, we are slightly different approach. We want those stocks that actually not so much involved in the semicon, because we saw the weakness in the semicon conductor numbers. I think that even Apple actually started to lower their production output, the forecast. So we want to be selective. We want to go into those sectors who are not really in this segment, and also I think they are not so influenced by the US dollar ringgit movement. And that's why we have both our EMS segment. That EMS basically is the electronic consumer product packaging side. Valuation-wise, they are cheaper, and also I think because they are dealing with volume, they are don't really, most of the cost structure is passed through to their customer, their OEM players, so that actually will less impact by US dollar movement. In this space, we have our SKP resources. Just recently also they announced they got a new contract from Dyson, 1 billion, 1 year for the next 5 years. So it will give them a very strong growth number. Easily, I think for the next 2 years, you can expect average will grow up close to 100% for the next 2 years because of this new contract. And our PE is still fairly cheap, in I think close to only 10 times. So that is a stock, the kind of stock that we wanted. In terms of underperformer, we have new sector, that is auto, simply because of big ticket item, and most of the players hit by the weaker ringgit, and the costs actually increase. And I think they are trying to pass down the cost to the consumer to maintain the margin, but I think that will probably hit their sales number. So either way, they either hit by the top line a slower sales number, or they hit by the lower margin. So for us, I think this sector probably, I think we try to avoid. If anything, also I think maybe B Auto would be a better bet if you keen into this sector. But for us, we try not to. For us, I think the clear cut players still the export oriented sectors, although I think ringgit play a very important role in the recent run up. I think we have been calling a buy for the export sector for the past 1 year. But I think beyond the ringgit, I think with the TTBN sign, I think that in general will benefit most of the export oriented counters, including our E&E, plastic, wood, textile. Or even I think automotive, if they actually some of the automotive parts maker, if they're going on export, then they will actually benefit in the longer run. So that basically in general is our market outlook and directions, and these are the top 10 picks we have during I think end of last year. As I said, I think people have been performed quite strongly. And I think SKP resources is one of the topics we have for the E&E or the tech sectors. Ta'an also I think is actually hit our target price, and actually we revised our target price higher right now. So we will see slightly more upside simply because I think they will benefit from the US dollar. And also I think the earnings from the Indo side is less volatile than before. Also I think one thing forgot to mention, for the export play, I think one thing you need to have in mind is I think you have to observe the second and third quarter result very carefully. It can be a turning point for all the export counters. If you recall, I think the ringgit only started to get weakened in August last year. That means to say, first quarter result for most of the export oriented counter is still good, they still benefit from the ringgit base. But coming into second quarter to third quarter, that means your base in terms of division in ringgit is not as obvious as before. So if you see a year-on-year weaker number, that can be a warning sign, and that can be a sign of derating. So we also here in the normal research, we actually monitor that trend very closely, because that can be a trend to cause the sell-down in some of the export-oriented concerns. Others I mentioned about the top of the EM, basically just a resilient play, just like the lager. Farmers worker basically is a healthcare play, also is resilient, and I would say the conservative play. Old Town F&B considered one of the resilient side. Amanda, me and Amanda is very different, although we are not keen on oil and gas, but I think in the long, because they have the long term contract, 7 years contract if they, when they go in to the business. So those are the long term contract, but you probably I think is less affected by the oil price. And also, I think the downstream player like Petchem prices actually move up quite fast. So, we used to have an outperform, but the share price now I think is very, very close to our target price, so we are not too keen with the Petchem. But I think for New Amanda, I think we still keen with potential. I think if anything, I think at this price level, we don't we won't be surprised if there is any corporate exercise. And even I think with the numbers, earning numbers, that should actually improve in FY17 because the new FPSO, which already got the contract, will actually start to deliver in I think the third quarter of this year. So we should see a better number in the second half. So we still keep Madan as our one of our topic. Okay, to sum it up before my end of my presentation, just to share slightly, I think just now you I think some of the audience here actually is very concerned about oil price. I think we actually have some study on oil as well. Probably I can just share with you before the end of this session. Okay, now in terms of oil, based on our simulation study, I think my mining in the Zubi is very close. Based on our simulation study, the probability for the oil to go beyond or to go below $25 per barrel is relatively low. I think. But I think for volatility for the oil, again back then when we did it was quite high, but below 30. So I guess 30 to 35 US dollar per barrel should be the range oil actually make trying to make a bottom. And for the full year, we are looking at about 38 US dollar per barrel as an average for oil. Now with that, I will conclude my presentation.